You spoke that church fathers are still very much relevant to the modern life. Well, however, most people here would not really call them patrologists, you know, but rather historians of late antiquity.
Yes, yes.
So, how to relate that? Well, I mean, in the modern West, where, you know, folks have really to invest years of studies. Well, I mean, I spent 7 years, you know, mastering ancient Greek, you know, and this sort of stuff. 7 years of life and of hard labor.
Yes.
So, how is it related to the modern change in life? And, well, especially when there is no actually religious motivation for that.
Yes, exactly. So, it's interesting that on the one hand, it's an extreme challenge for the discipline because in Australia, for instance, and other Western countries, the expense involved in devoting your life to studying the languages that are required is becoming something that young people are less and less invested in because they don't see the point of it. On the other hand, I think we also have a growing number of young people who are getting excited by the church fathers and by the relevance of that material and seeing it as something that helps to give order to their lives and to provide meaning in a very uncertain century, which is the 21st century. So I there's always, I think, for us going to be this tension between the fact that the universities and students themselves don't see the point of studying the languages required to work in this field, and the fact that they want to increasingly work only with translations, and so their understanding of the sensitivities of the material they're reading can be quite poor, and the fact that then there are students who are willing to then still invest a lot of time and in the end money in countries where education is expensive, developing the skills, and usually they realize that after the fact, so after they've tried to start grappling with the texts and then realizing that they don't have the skills necessary. And I mean, in Australia, we have students now who do not have the linguistic skills necessary to engage deeply. And it's actually going to be an increasing problem for the field. So how to excite them and get them to understand and governments to understand that these are still critical skills for people is a deep challenge for us.
So, but what are their motivation, you know, for studying church fathers?
Well, so I argued...
Are they churchy?
No. Some of these people have no church background. So what I'm arguing is that there's actually enormous amount of ethical crossover, the kind of humanitarian crises that the church fathers are facing, the kind of ethical issues that they're facing, the kind of human anthropology that they're dealing with is so relevant to common, 21st century life. So part of it is our job is to encourage people to understand that and get them excited about it. So, I mean, there's a possibility for a renaissance, I think, in the study of the church fathers, at the same time as we're also challenged to get people interested in the church fathers. But the fact that people are increasingly less invested in institutional religion, Christianity, for instance, is, I think, not a problem, really, for the study of this discipline.
Thank you so much. But In the Orthodox Church and, you know, and probably in the Roman Catholic Church, yeah, too, today we have a really huge problem with the Church Fathers. Because previously, in the 19th century and even before, we developed a concept of consensus patrum.
Yes, yes.
Which means all the Fathers actually say the same.
Yes.
More or less. Yeah. Well, they may differ. Well, but it's not really relevant and very important because in the crucial matters, they say the same. However, the patristic studies in the 20th century proved that that was not the point.
Yes, and in the 21st century, we're proving that, in fact, the fluidity in thought and the great variability in thought and the diversity of the way they approach issues is part of the relevance, I think, for the 21st century. It's that there is not this deposit of the faith that the 19th century and 20th century invested in, but that was the modern view of the past. That was them almost reflecting their own concerns back on the church fathers. Now in the 21st century, we are actually embracing that extreme diversity across the church fathers. Even maybe this is heretical to say this, but even church fathers that were viewed as heretics were maybe not as heretical as people thought. Often it was a different in emphasis in the way they were looking at the world that may in fact have something to say today in ways that our own institutional churches have not recognized. So it's a very challenging time, I think, for institutional Orthodox religion and Catholicism in ways that also, if they embrace that more diverse way of looking at the church fathers, would actually help them to renew their own church and the future, I think. So it's one of those things where I think institutional Christianity, particularly ones who are invested in the deposit of the faith, I find the 21st century very challenging. I think where patristics is heading in the 21st century speaks to the transformation that institutional religion is going through as it's challenged by 21st century a decline in belief in institutional Christianity. So to me, it's a very exciting time, I think, for patristics in the 21st century.
It's really very interesting. And the final question is about this very conference. Well, did you like it?
Yeah, so I've been coming for 24 years now. So it's been interesting to observe the changes, and I talked about that a bit in my paper. I always enjoy this conference. I am deeply invested in the study of the Church Fathers, even though I'm actually a Protestant, so I'm a Lutheran. And I come from a church that basically thinks nothing happened between the New Testament and Luther and the Reformation. But for me, I mean, I the more I work in a theological school now that is dealing with challenging 21st century issues in Australia, the more I realize how much my own formation in the Church Fathers is deeply relevant. And it's so exciting always to be here and to talk with other scholars who have similar investment in the relevance of this study, but also just to, you know, go into the very deep traditional approaches, the text editing, the manuscripts, everything that we need to do foundationally in order to do the kinds of more contemporary relevant study. So, I mean, we need everything. We need those deep approaches. We need that very minute philological work. And we need that kind of, here's what the Church Fathers say on this ethical issue or environmental crises or that kind of study. So, I mean, to me, this is a wonderful place to come and meet other scholars from around the world. And it's become very international now. Far more people from South America, from Asian countries. The more we get people from Africa, the more I will believe that we have truly internationalized, but again, from Russia and from, you know, countries that once would not have been very well represented here, very well represented now, and increasingly so.
Thank you so much indeed.